Good evening. I would like to start out by telling you that this program is being taped on Thursday, September 8th. At this very moment, the popularity contest of the year is taking place here in New York. Over the course of the summer, all but one of the mayoral candidates were invited to appear on this program and discuss the gay rights issue. Out of those invited, only one saw fit to find the time. I hope she pulled through. For those of you who were lucky enough to have spent the summer out of town, you didn't miss very much. The weather was, there were only a handful of days all season when the weather was really up to par. The sun only managed to break through the ozone layer a few times in July, and the air quality was unacceptable the entire month of August. It seems that it may have been a coincidence, but one of the nicest days of the season weather-wise was the day of the Christopher Street Liberation Day parade. This evening marks the start of our sixth month of programming. For those viewers who have been with us since the beginning, we would appreciate your comments, criticisms, whatever. We'd like to keep up to a certain standard in both quality and content on the program, and that can only be achieved through the increased sales of commercials. So the answer is simple: more commercials, better content. Tonight, Mr. Michael Moran, whose background is in film, will be talking with Charles Hicks, author of Looking Good, a new book which is stirring up a fair amount of comment these days, especially the cover. Later on in the program, backed by very popular demand and returning to the grand finale later this week, Wayland Flowers and Madam, so please stay with us for that. Now that most of the brunt of the entire Anita Bryant thing has died down somewhat, one only hears occasional reinforcements of her activities in the media these days. The former Miss Oklahoma's name most recently appeared in the news several weeks ago when the United States National Weather Bureau announced that the first storm of the season was going to be called Hurricane Anita. This fact sparked the interest of yet another person from Oklahoma and further inspired him to write a song about it. He's with us tonight. His name is Lynn Frizzell. Lynn, how are you?
Fine.
Lynn, how soon after you heard that they were going to name this storm Hurricane Anita did you jump on the bandwagon, so to speak?
Well, actually, I wrote the song before I knew the storm was going to be Anita. I tried to think of a creative way to express myself. Miami, of course, being the center, the hurricane center for the country, and Anita, of course, appropriately would be A on the alphabet, so hence the season's first bad storm.
Did you write the music as well as the lyrics?
Yes, I did.
Everything?
Uh-huh.
You're a musician by... You play piano?
I play guitar.
Guitar. Mm-hmm. Who produced the record?
It was produced by Carlson Productions of Hollywood, Florida. It was recorded on location in Fort Lauderdale, where the boys are.
Yeah. I heard a little bit of it, and I'd really like to know, why did you choose the gay over the very popular disco?
Well, I would have preferred disco. We ran into a slight problem because of the timeliness of the song, obviously, and the producer thought it would be a lot quicker to do a sort of a reggae version, since it was the beat at the time was very appropriate for reggae. And so rather than to go into a really long, drawn-out production, we stuck with reggae. Although at the moment, we're up in New York negotiating with some major record labels who are very interested in picking up the song, including the biggest record company. And they are very interested in terms of doing a disco number.
Well, I really like it. I'm just going to play a little of it for you. Why don't you run it? Okay, we'll have a little listen here. What can I say? It's actually about 4 minutes long, but we can only play a little of it. It is 4 minutes, isn't it?
Yes.
Lynn, are you yourself, or is the Miami Victory campaign promoting this record?
Well, the Miami Victory campaign produced the record. They paid for the cost of the record. They're promoting it around the country. It's available by mail order. The advertising campaign has not been as extensive because obviously they do have limited funds for that sort of thing, and the song is a fundraiser.
Mm-hmm. So you only had a couple of weeks. When did you write this?
I wrote it in May. Mm-hmm. I was there for the election, sang in Miami. In fact, I confronted a number of Save Our Children people who were more or less challenging me with some of their hymns.
Mm-hmm.
But the Miami Victory campaign is promoting it, although I'm doing it in person by going on location to a number of cities around the country. In fact, I plan to follow Anita around. She'll be in Richmond October 8th for the Baptist Convention, and I would like to see Hurricane Anita hit Richmond at that point.
Mm-hmm. You mean the storm physically, or the record of the storm?
Either or both.
Well, tell me, in closing, how does one go about getting a copy?
Well, it's available, as I say, by mail order. That's the surest way to get it, by writing to the Miami Victory Campaign, Box 1976, Miami Beach, Florida, 33139. A number of bookstores in the village are also selling it, too.
It lasts a while, probably.
The Leatherman is one that I can think of offhand. A couple of stores on Christopher Street are also selling it.
Well, Lynn, I wish you an awful lot of luck with this.
Well, thank you very much.
I'm excited about it. I think it'll get a lot of play. Thank you very much for appearing today.
Thank you.
We'll be right back with Charles Hicks, author of Looking Good, right after this. Stay tuned.
And
Avenue between 87th and 88th.
Good evening. This is Michael Moran at the Emerald City, and this evening we're going to be talking with Mr. Charles Hicks, who wrote the book Looking Good. Good evening.
Hi.
How are you?
We laughed, I hope.
Okay. I wanted to tell you, I got the book the other night, and Frank, the producer, gave it to me. And I was sitting in a restaurant and reading it with a friend of mine, and we were talking about the book and what it had done and what it attempted to do. And so we thought it had been done pretty well. In the middle of the conversation, someone got up from a table, two tables away, and came over and wanted to know the exact title of the book, where it could be had, and how much it was.
Bravo. You just keep carrying the book with you everywhere you go.
Well, that's one customer. Anyway.
Right.
Tell me, how did you get into doing Looking Good?
I was lucky, if we want to call it luck. The publisher called me, and they had decided that they wanted to do a men's grooming book, and my name came up as a freelance writer who had written a lot on the subject.
Mm-hmm.
So I was very eager, and the next morning went and had a meeting, and about a week later I had a contract, and we were working on Looking Good.
I noticed that in reading it that it's really a very solid kind of book of its kind. It's really from the ground up. It starts with the most basic things and takes it to the most sophisticated kind of grooming concept.
Yeah, thanks a lot. I really tried for it to be that. I feel that enough hasn't been written about men's grooming, that a lot of guys who are interested but who just really don't know how to go about it. So I figured if I could just start with the very fundamental thing, explain why somebody should use a moisturizer in terms of what happens to the skin. I just like what happens in women's magazines where they just say, use this perfume or use this cream and you're suddenly going to be spectacular. I think that people should know why they're doing something. So I hope that it isn't boring, but I tried to, you know, give rationale for doing things.
Mm-hmm. I understand the sales of it are going very good.
Yeah. I really didn't expect it to do as well as it is. Like, the first printing came out in New York officially August 1st, and it was sold out. And so then they had to go back into a second printing, and now I'm into a third printing. So every time that there's a new printing, that means more people are buying it. So it's nice.
Yeah. One of the things I sort of noticed in reading the book was that that many of the things I really knew, but it sort of put them all together very well. And it made me feel like it suddenly dawned on me that this kind of cohesive, it's sort of like a book like Passages does, or any of the awareness kind of books that make you just aware of an area of life.
Yeah, again,
and
I
do it cohesively.
Yeah, there has to be a total scheme. And, you know, that's why, you know, like some guys say, gee, what should I do about my hair?
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, it's fine to be concerned about your hair, but, you know, like, as part of the whole thing. So I tried. I'm glad that you found it, though.
Mm-hmm. There's an interesting, I'm sure a lot of the viewers would be interested, there's a really interesting collection of men in the book. It's sort of all gamuts, and I guess the thing that really ties them together is that each one in their own particular way is a very attractive, good example of their kind.
Yeah, I think that the models in the book really look terrific. And Bruce Weber did the photographer.
Mm-hmm.
I think that he's one of the finest photographers in the country or world. And I think that he has a great talent in photographing men. You know, like, he does work for some of the fashion magazines, and even there you see something that's very special about what he does. But, you know, like, he doesn't photograph men to be plastic. He mm-hmm. photographs, you know, to get something that's special about them, and I think he did a terrific job.
Mm-hmm. I understand that's gotten you in some trouble. that the statement's been made that I didn't particularly find it so, but that because all the men were so attractive, they had to be gay.
That
was your reaction.
Yeah, that was the reaction. And I think, are you saying that only gay men are attractive? You know, yeah. I've done some interviews that always comes up. Oh, but those guys are so fantastic. How can an average guy relate to them? And it's such a crazy double standard, because in a woman's beauty book or in a fashion book, a magazine, you wouldn't expect to see slumps of women. So, I mean, it just seems logical that you should have very attractive men when you're talking about looking good.
Mm-hmm. Well, I was amazed because some of the people, well, the guy on the cover, who must be a great selling factor for you, is particularly handsome, but there are a number of men in the book who are, I think, look very, very good in a sort of Ivy League way or a very Wall Street way.
Yeah.
And I felt like one of the things in the book was sort of tailor your own look to your lifestyle, what you need your business on.
Right. Yeah, I mean, I try not to dictate at all in the book and say, oh, you should look like this. The whole idea is calling for men to think about themselves, to look at themselves, to analyze, you know, the good points, the bad points, what things they can improve, what things they can camouflage, but ultimately to come up with a look that makes them happy, pleased with themselves. You know, like I think Matt is terrific looking, but I mean, I could never look like that. And to try to adapt Matt's image would be totally wrong for me and a lot of other people. So somebody's got to get in touch with himself. And I don't think that looking good, on the other hand, is just a superficial thing. I mean, it goes deeper. You feel better. It's not a self-help book in the respect it's going to open up new mind horizons, but I think that somebody can feel better when they realize they're making the most of themselves.
I think so. One of the things that you said in the book, and it's kind of simplistic, but it's really seemed true to me that if you're happy and you love, you look better, and if you hate and turn inward, it makes you look bad. So if the only reason you can figure out is vanity for being a loving person, then that's the reason.
Well, you know, we were talking earlier about stress.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, like, our skin, you know, everything about us responds so much to things, to the emotional climate. And so, however somebody gets to be content with himself or herself, I don't care how it's done, but it's the person is physically going to look better. I mean, I know, as you said, it sounds simple, but I keep, you know, trying to push it through, because people, if they get uptight about analyzing themselves, and if they say, oh, well, I can't, you know, there's nothing I can do, then I've defeated everything for them.
One of the things I thought was interesting, I noticed in the things that you've done before the book, that you wrote for Gentleman's Quarterly and Playboy and have written for a number, Esquire, a number of publications, and that you, and many of these have been ongoing columns, so I feel like you're probably very in touch with the whole side of America, that men are really changing. They're becoming image conscious in a very positive way, and they're getting less afraid of it.
Yeah, I thought that, Michael, and I still kind of think it, but when I hear little rumbles from the Midwest, I'm dealing with the sales of the book, you know, saying it's doing fantastically well in New York, it's doing marvelously in Los Angeles, and it's doing so-so in the Midwest. So changes, yes, but maybe not as rapidly as we would hope that the changes have been.
Well, maybe this book will be some encouragement.
Oh, I hope so.
Towards that. Tell me, are the men in the book generally professional models?
Almost all of them are. There are a few who are not, who are just like personal friends of the photographer or myself.
What was the inspiration really for this particular format of those? Were you going for it's sort of like a cocktail table book, something between that and an encyclopedia.
Yeah, the inspiration really came when I started thinking that I wanted to work with Bruce Weber as the photographer, and then I thought that he photographs things so beautifully that you can't put it into a small little standard size. And then I started thinking, you know, like, some people might get bored if it was just chapter after chapter of, you know, shampoo your hair or brush your teeth. And so wanted a book that would be designed well, that would just be a pleasure to look at. It just kind of evolved that way. And I think it really, Brian Burdine did the cover. I had to mention that because he's a friend of mine who, I said, Hawthorne, you've got to get this guy to do the cover.
I remember in the dedications in the book, I think there are about five of them, that was the one I remembered, because I think you said, God bless Brian, because he was completely hungover, he could see with a dead eye on Monday morning.
That was it, because it was a terrible day when we started laying it out.
Well, that's interesting because the book itself would almost be worth buying if there were no text because
right.
the photograph is...
Oh, you have killed me.
No. It's just that it's really well done.
Yeah, I agree.
And, to the people who did that work, they do. Well, do you have any new plans in the work? What's the...
There are two possibilities of books that I may do. They're not... You know, I haven't negotiated them. They're just two ideas that I hope will materialize into books and then just continue freelancing and also going out on the road. I'll be touring about 15 cities trying to hype up interest in the book.
That's incredible. As I understand, that's really how books are, how bestsellers are made.
Yeah, I don't...
In large measure.
Right. Hawthorne keeps saying to me, you know, Chuck, we may have a bestseller here. And I keep saying, don't tell me that. You know, I don't want to hear it. I don't want to get nervous about it. You know, I'll go out, I'll do the promoting, I'll be, like, this is fun. You know, some of them are awful. But, you know, saying, okay, I'll do it. You know, but don't give me promises about bestseller lists or great paperback sale. When it happens, it happens.
Well, I won't say anything.
Okay.
Frankly, I think it's a winner. Well, Charles, thank you very much for being with us this evening. I appreciate you taking the time and coming in and showing us your book. And thank you for all the men.
Okay.
That it's good for.
Thanks. I liked it.
Good evening.
In the September issue of Christopher Street, read an exciting interview with Andy Warhol. Also, a look at the darker side of the 50s, a review of the 60s and Fantasia on the 70s. Christopher Street, on sale now at your local newsstand.
Just an hour and a half away in Atlantic City, New Jersey, is the most all-inclusive gay complex in the Northeast. The Grand Central Resort features over 175 beautiful rooms, including penthouse suites. And just an elevator ride away, the Showbiz Lounge with spectacular stage shows, the After Dark Piano Bar, Atlantic City's famous Eminem Disco, and right on the premises, Club Baths Atlantic City. Right off the boardwalk, the Grand Central Resort in Atlantic City. For reservations, call 609-344-1922. Come on down. The Grand Central Resort is no gamble.
Returning September 15th to the grand finale, Wayland Flowers and Madam.
Direct from Hollywood, Wayland Flowers and Madam.
Garland is alive. Well, good evening, everybody. My name is Madam, and I'm an alcoholic. Oh, crap, it's the wrong group. Well, I do so many benefits, what can I tell you? Now, for those of you who've never seen us before, my name really is Madam, and this is Wayland Flowers over here. Now, you may have noticed, Wayland is no ventriloquist. And I am no fucking dummy. Well, since I've seen you last, I've been on a lot of things. I've been on Don Ho, I've been on Andy Williams, and I've been on Quaaludes. I told my doctor out in L.A., the way things are shaking out here, I'd rather be cracking than quaking. Oh, my God, Hollywood. You don't know what a town that is. Isn't it wonderful to wake up in a town and listen to the birds coughing in the trees? Everything out there has got a Queen Anne front and a Mary Anne behind. But I'll tell you what I really think of Hollywood's BAL. Hit it, Gary. shovel all the coal in. Gotta keep it rolling. Take me back to Manhattan. Take me back to New York. I'm on the east side, the west side, the north side, and the south side. So take me back to Manhattan. Margaret, I fell right down on my ass. I know I don't look like her, but what the hell? Neither does she anymore, does she? Oh, my God. Want to talk about drag? Look at this shit. I don't want you to think I've gone Hollywood on you. Actually, I bought this at Lana Turner's garage sale. I found a crab in it the other night. Here's that thing. It's over here somewhere. I can find it. Oh, there it is now. Oh, you little bugger, you multiply. I heard the best way to get rid of a crab. A Jewish friend of mine told me. He's gay. My favorite Hebrew. What he says, he says, what you do, you take you some sour cream, mirror it on your private. Little buggers, he didn't get to fat the ball off. Well, I've got to tell you a little bit about Hollywood. You know, I take Maud wherever I go. I met Maud, my good friend. Well, actually, let me tell you something. I'm a little sorry I was a little late getting out here this evening, but I was backstage with my fiancé. That's French for the guy I'm fucking now. I mean, those Frenchmen are so wishy-washy, you don't know if you're going to get wished to walk. Doesn't much matter, though, once I get my wish, I usually walk. He is gorgeous, though, you ought to see him. 6'5", blonde, blue eyes, 19. I don't think that's a bad IQ for a guy 17 years old. Well, the other night, Maud, my best friend, told me, says, Madam, you ought to be ashamed of yourself. Dating that young kid, be more careful. To be fatal. But oh, what the hell, Maud? If he dies, he dies. Anyhow, Maud and I have finally taken an apartment out there in Hollywood. Maud used to be in show business till her donkey died. She told me the other night she wanted to get her act back together. I said, well, it ought not to be hard to find a loose ass running around Hollywood somewhere. She's getting on all time for the gong show. Well, we've got an apartment out there in Hollywood. I rented, I called Abby Rent to get the furniture for it. They'll rent anything. So I've done the whole apartment in party supplies and sick room fixtures. It's lovely. However, I hate sleeping in an iron lung. Ma just loves it. She doesn't have to worry about breathing. Just plugs it in the wall there. I do like the little mirrors up over our faces. I can put my makeup on in the morning without getting out of bed. Well, let me tell you. The other morning, the doorbell rang, so I pulled myself out of the lung, sauntered over to the door there, opened it up. It was one of those Hare Krishna guys standing there. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Don't you love the way they dress? Terribly trendy, don't you think? They shave their hair with a little ponytail hanging in the back, wear the little striped caftan with a chimney shoes. Oh, they've really got it all together. Well, he had a cup he was shaking in my face. I said, I suppose you want a donation. He said, yes, I do. I said, I'll give you a $100 bill if you learn a new song. Right. Well, I turned around. Maud was standing there in a scuffy. That's all she wears around the house. I don't know why she took a long trip all the way down there. But anyhow, Maud turned to me. She says, madam. I said, yes, Maud. She says, I haven't seen one Hollywood star since we've been out here. I said, but let's go to the Brown Derby for the camp. So we got all dialed up, head for the Brown Derby, get there early. I leaned over the table, I said, no more. Don't order a Coca-Cola no matter what you do this early in the morning.